Good evening. My name is Alan Journey. I am one of the co-facilitators of Southern Oregon Climate Action Now. Sitting next to me is the other co-facilitator, Kathy Conway, and you'll be hearing much more from Kathy in just a moment and much more indeed later. My task is to introduce the program, but first a few tips. Please mute yourself now and stay muted throughout the program just in case the dog barks. If you have any questions as we're going, please open chat, which is at the bottom of your screen, and type your questions in the chat box, then press return after typing to submit, and they'll go to everybody. And Kathy will be collecting the questions and asking them when we get to the Q&A. For screen options, go to the upper right corner and select view, and go select side-by-side speaker or side-by-side gallery, depending on which approach you prefer. As you will have gathered, this presentation will be recorded, is being recorded, so folks who can't join us this evening have the benefit of watching the video.
It's my honor to acknowledge the traditional custodians of the land most of us are on today, the Tecoma, the Shasta, Klamath, and Modoc, and to pay our respect to their elders, past, present, and emerging.
The format for this evening is going to follow that which we have been accustomed to experiencing during our Zoom years. My goodness, it does seem a long time, doesn't it? We're going to move after my introductory remarks to the presentation. As I mentioned, Kathy will be collecting questions from the chat and then posing them to Phil when we get to that point. And then after the Q&A, Kathy will also be offering a summary of what SOCAN and other climate groups in the area are doing. So without more ado, I will... there's one more thing that I have to add. Again, as is our custom, Kathy has set up an action page on the SOCAN website. So if you go to socan.eco/action, you will be able to revisit all the ideas that Phil shares with us this evening about things we can do both to help our children's trust and to address the climate crisis. Okay, before I introduce Phil, I'd like to acknowledge Noel Studer-Spevak and participants from Families for Climate, which I think is a Portland-based organization. And I'd like to thank you guys for joining us for this evening's program. Many of us in the climate activist arena in Oregon have been following the activities of Our Children's Trust for many years, always with excitement at the prospect of what they might achieve. As you may know, Our Children's Trust takes climate action in the form of lawsuits against federal and state governments for their violations of our youth's constitutional rights and for harming both young people and the natural resources these governments hold in trust for future generations. This evening, we are delighted to be able to entertain Phil Gregory, who has been with Our Children's Trust since 2010. He has served as of counsel with Our Children's Trust on a pro bono basis, all while maintaining his litigation practice with the Gregory Law Group. Phil asked me specifically to not spend my time introducing him, but to mention Our Children's Trust. And so without more ado, I'll pass the baton to Phil to talk to us about what Our Children's Trust is doing. Thanks so much for joining us, Phil.
Thank you all, and thank you for being in attendance. I'm gonna get to share screen here and start the slide program. For your edification, I'm down in the Palo Alto, California area. I live near Stanford, And I've been, as Alan said, and thank you, Alan, for limiting your introduction, I've been involved with our Children's Trust since the beginning in 2010, and it did in fact begin in Eugene. But before we start talking about climate, I'd like to talk about a couple other quick issues. The first is civil rights. And let's recognize that the core issue for youth in the last century was education and the issue of separate but equal, particularly segregation in education. And the Supreme Court's constitutional decision in Brown versus Board of Education declaring that segregation in public education was unconstitutional has resonated to this day. Now we turn to this century, and climate change, I believe, as does Mary Robinson, and I'm sure most on this presentation, is the greatest threat, and I believe the greatest civil rights issue in the 21st century in our country. And well, why is that? Let's do a little bit of science. And this graph looks crude, but it gets to the point real quickly. It's through human forcing of carbon dioxide, particularly shown here by parts per million. If you see the yellow line going across, at 350 parts per million, we're at 417 or higher, depending on who you listen to, but much higher than we should be right now due to human activities. And you can see below how the global average temperature and sea level have for a gazillion years tracked carbon dioxide. And we're not doing any better getting rid of the CO2. And you can see where it's coming from: cement, flaring gas, oil, coal. And you can see what the observations and Mauna Loa have indicated. Well, why does that matter? Well, for youth, and particularly starting prior to birth and going all the way through adolescence, climate change poses significant risks for youth during their development. And that's why our Children's Trust since 2010 has advocated for youth, particularly advocating only for science-based, legally enforceable systemic remedies to protect fundamental human rights. And the primary case that we've worked on is the Giuliana case, Giuliana versus United States. And I'm going to give a little bit of background on Giuliana for those of you who were not able to watch the movie Youth v. Gov, whether in the theaters or on Netflix. In August 2015, 21 youth brought Giuliana in the United States District Court in Eugene, Oregon, against the Obama administration. So a lot of people think we started this case by suing the Trump administration. No, we sued the Obama administration. And it's because the federal government's affirmative actions, not the failure. You often read about Giuliana's a case of the government not doing enough or failing to act. That's hooey. That's not what our case is about. It's the federal government's affirmative, ongoing conduct in creating, perpetuating, and controlling a national fossil fuel-based energy system, despite long-standing knowledge of the resulting destruction of our nation and the profound harm that would occur to these young plaintiffs, because the target time frame was back in the 1960s, was in the first few decades of this century. Let me give you an example. This is a memo from President Nixon's White House. It's written by Daniel Patrick Monahan, who was then a science advisor, went on to become senator from New York. In September 1969, he writes John Ehrlichman about the carbon dioxide problem, which he says will essentially result in apocalyptic change. And I'm not sure you can read the bottom, I've highlighted it, but it says that this in turn could raise the level of the sea by 10 feet. Goodbye, New York, goodbye, Washington. This is one of the many memos and reports that we unearthed in going to the presidential libraries of Presidents Kennedy, Johnson, and Nixon, and other presidents to get evidence supporting our assertion of the longstanding knowledge of the significant problem. So Juliana is a case based on right to life, right to liberty, right to security, as well as equal protection of the law and protection of the public trust resources. Public trust resources being essential natural resources such as air, water, and the ocean. Our case is before federal judge Ann Aiken in Eugene, Oregon, who in November 2016 denied the Obama administration's request to dismiss the case, finding that she had no doubt that the right to a climate system capable of sustaining human life is fundamental to a free and ordered society. Here's a photo of Judge Aiken. And if you haven't read her November 2016 decision, I strongly urge you to read it because she focuses on, as you see in the underlined portion there, governmental action that is affirmatively and substantially damaging the climate system. I'm not going to go through all the procedural hurdles, the ping-ponging that Juliana went through. I can if you want to during questions, but essentially we found ourselves in the summer of 2019 on interlocutory appeal before three judges of the Ninth Circuit. And the issues there were standing. Standing is a concept that you can't get into the courthouse door unless you can initially establish you, the plaintiff, has been injured, the defendants caused your injury, and the court can remediate the injury or do something about the injury. And the three judges there, if you look on the left, that's Judge Hurwitz, Judge Murguia, and Judge Staten on the right. What we won all through the case, and it's very important to indicate what we won on, that we had valid Fifth Amendment claims, we could challenge systemic government conduct, we were injured, and that the federal government was a substantial cause of the injuries. And the Ninth Circuit, all the judges of the Ninth Circuit, all three, pointed to the substantial evidentiary record that the government has long promoted fossil fuel use, even knowing that it may hasten an environmental apocalypse. Even though there's ample evidence that as to our plaintiffs, two here, the Juliana plaintiffs, that the testimony is that it exacerbated their medical conditions, it damaged their property, it inflicted psychological harm. For here, Jamie, who was then living on the Navajo Nation, she's faced extreme drought and extreme heat. We have the story of Jaden, and I won't go into it except to say that one morning, just before we argued the motion to dismiss, Jaden woke up in her home in Rain, Louisiana, and stepped into sewage and water because her home had flooded as a result of the climate crisis. And the Ninth Circuit found that the country is not only knew about the problem and that the problem is real, but that the country is expanding oil and gas extraction. And to give you an example, here's the chart. If you take a moment and look at this chart, the red line is the mean CO2 concentration, what we'll call the 350 line. And the other parts of the chart are U.S. fossil fuel production under various presidents. And people wonder why we sued President Obama. There is more fossil fuels that left the ground in the United States under President Obama than in any prior president, no matter what he said about being a climate change god. And so the majority focuses on the fact that absent some action, the destabilizing climate will bury cities, spawn life-threatening natural disasters, and jeopardize critical food and water supplies. And they agree with the dissent, and you're going to hear about the dissent in just a second, on the gravity of the evidence. The issue was, could a federal court provide a remedy? And the majority said, you know what, kids? We can't provide the remedy you want. What you need to do is you need to go vote. So they were telling 11-year-old Levi, you got to go and get your remedy through the ballot box. And we all know, if you know anything about climate, that the situation is going to get worse, or as Kurt Vonnegut ably put it, the excrement's going to hit the air conditioning, and it's not going to occur while, what let's call it, the more senior of us are alive, but it's going to occur when these youth are hitting our age. And so the dissent, written by Judge Staten out of the Central District of California, said that the government, and this is exactly right, what the government asserted on appeal in Juliana, was that the federal government has the absolute and unreviewable, I want to underline that word, unreviewable power to destroy our nation. And she noted there's a huge amount of authority that federal rights don't depend on the ballot box. They're the beyond the reach of majorities. And she concludes her wonderful dissent, which I would commend to you to read, when the seas envelop our coastal cities, fires and droughts haunt our interiors, and storms ravage everything in between, those remaining will ask, why did so many do so little? We've brought other cases, and I'm going to talk more about them in a bit, but all of these cases talk about in the dissents that the courts must not shrink from their obligations to determine what the law requires. Here's our case, Chernick versus Brown in 2020. Another opinion out of the state of Washington, again reiterating, courts should not avoid their constitutional obligations. There's even in Alaska a stinging dissent that when the Alaska case was thrown out, that the court should take steps like issuing a declaratory judgment. So right now, where's Juliana? After the Ninth Circuit, we decided to amend our complaint to seek a declaratory judgment as to the constitutional rights and whether the federal government is violating those rights. We argued this motion in June 2021, and we're waiting a decision from Judge Aiken. And I want to point out that the Biden-Harris administration is now the third administration to be defendants in Juliana. And the Biden administration could, rather than fight these youth, have a trial, put the evidence before a judge, put the evidence before the public, so that a sensible resolution based on the science can be arrived at to hopefully secure the rights of this nation to address the climate crisis. We need a constitutional mandate because we all know, those of you listening here know, that executive orders aren't worth the paper they're written on. The next administration could avoid those orders, but a declaration that the government is violating the Constitution as issued by a federal court can outlast any administration and provide meaningful reasons to permanently alter the government's conduct. So let's review the key points on Giuliani. It's a constitutional case. It's not a statutory case. We, the plaintiffs, established our injuries, and we established that the government is causing those injuries. The issue right now is not whether or not the climate crisis exists. The issue in Giuliani is, what is the role of federal courts in constitutional cases? Like where I began in Brown versus Board of Education, does the judiciary have a duty to issue declaratory relief? So just like the way the Supreme Court went about destroying the status quo of segregation in Brown versus Board of Education, declaratory relief will be incredibly helpful in addressing the climate crisis at the federal level, so that our environment will not be left to the politicians, but it will be left to the scientists and to the evidence in the courtroom. As Alexander Hamilton wrote, the job of the judge is to enforce the supreme and enduring law of the Constitution over the current will of the majority, over the will of the fossil fuel interests. And as Judge Aiken noted in 2018, courts have an equally important duty to fulfill their role as a check. Remember your grade school civics, checks and balance, a check on any unconstitutional actions of the other branches of government. So how can you help? These are our plaintiffs in front of the Supreme Court. Well, you can watch the movie on Netflix, or often it's in film festivals, like earlier this year was at a film festival in Eugene. There's a petition that you can get at through the Our Children's Trust website that in essence says that Attorney General Garland, you should stop opposing Giuliani from going to trial. Let the youth be heard. Put the evidence on in a courtroom. As we are often say, I don't know if you remember that it used to be fake news. That was a big thing several years ago. Well, you know what? In the courtroom, fake news is perjury. So what we want to do is get government officials under oath in a courtroom stating how the federal government is harming these plaintiffs. You can also join the Our Children's Trust group of donors. I'm not sure you know this, but Our Children's Trust is the world's only public interest law firm representing youth in constitutional climate cases at no cost to the youth or their families. And please, if you haven't donated, donate $5. It doesn't matter what the number of donors is significant, as we all know, if you've written grants or gone out and tried to raise money. So it's really helpful because people like me, help us to the extent we need travel expenses and the like, even though we're working for free. And you can sign on to follow our Children's Trust by joining the online mailing list and following it on social media. Other things you can do is contact your own member of Congress to tell the Attorney General to back off and allow Giuliana to go to trial. Or you can go to our Children's Trust website, where there's what's called an action toolkit about how the local level, along with schools and faith communities and local businesses, you can get a declaration of support signed. And finally, you can just talk to others about the climate science. If you're unsure about the climate science, our Children's Trust has a link to a pathway to climate recovery that I would strongly urge you to read. Now, our Children's Trust isn't just involved in Giuliana. It brings cases throughout our nation and internationally. One case I'm also involved in is the case we have going in the state of Montana called Held. These are the plaintiffs throughout the state of Montana. And the Montana Constitution, interestingly, was rewritten in the early 70s. And it has language that includes among the inalienable rights are a right to a clean and healthful environment. And the state shall maintain a clean and healthful environment for the preservation of future generations. I mean, I wish our federal constitution had these rights explicitly in the constitution. But, you know, like many states, Montana has tried to get around these constitutional provisions by passing statutes that support a fossil fuel driven energy system. And so the Held case is all about whether or not these statutes and the work of the agencies pursuant to these statutes violate the constitutional rights. And we're in discovery right now in Montana in the Held case, and we hope to have a trial in Helena in 2023. And here's our two of our plaintiffs and our trial judge, Judge Seeley, who's based in Helena. Now, we also have a case in Virginia. Here are some of the Virginia plaintiffs. Again, like the Giuliana plaintiffs, they all have suffered harms, whether through asthma or and other respiratory issues or other harms as a result of the climate crisis. And so, and by way of background, in Virginia, they amended their constitution to add a conservation article where the Commonwealth's policy is to protect its atmosphere, lands, and waters from pollution, impairment, or destruction. And so the case, Layla versus the Commonwealth, argues that in permitting fossil fuels and that the Commonwealth is contributing to the climate crisis and violating the youth's rights. Next month, on September 16, we'll be arguing the equivalent of a motion to dismiss in Richmond, Virginia, that the state has brought to try to get rid of the case early on. I'll be in attendance, and I think Kimberly from our Children's Trust, who I saw earlier, also will be there. We also have a case in Utah, which essentially makes the same argument that the state is actively causing and contributing to Utah's hazardous air. And there we're having oral argument on the motion to dismiss on September 8 in Salt Lake City. and Andrew Welly of our Children's Trust will be arguing that. And I should have said Nate Bellinger of our Children's Trust will be arguing the Virginia motion to dismiss. And then we have a case in Hawaii, another case where a motion to dismiss is coming up in Hawaii. Essentially, the issue there involves the transportation system on Hawaii, resulting in high levels of greenhouse gas emissions of violating the state constitutional rights. And there's a motion to dismiss coming up. I believe that's in October or November, where there'll be a hearing in Hawaii. And the key thing about these state defendants, the way the states essentially object to these cases, is that they argue that because everyone's affected the same way, then no one has really been injured because it's what's called a generalized grievance. Or they also say, you know what, we're only one drop in the ocean of fossil fuel emissions. It's a global problem. And so you courts should not order the state to do anything about it. Then they say they apply various immunities, that the defendants are immune from constitutional review. And these are the arguments that we have to face in these motions to dismiss. We're also involved in cases throughout the world. And at some point, hopefully, I'll be invited back, or Kelly Matheson, who is our global litigation head based in Amsterdam, can speak to you about all the global actions we're either involved in or trying to get started, whether it's in Canada, Mexico, throughout Europe, Pakistan, in Africa. We're really working hard to represent youth before these governmental bodies, to try to get them to recognize the importance, like we are in Juliana, of governmental action causing the climate crisis. Many people ask me, why do I do this pro bono? Why aren't I out earning the big bucks? And I have three grandchildren. Here's my granddaughter, Alice, who's with Kelsey Juliana here. And at some point, my grandchildren are going to ask me, you know, Papa, what'd you do during the climate wars? And I want to be able to say that, you know, rather than spend all the time I wanted with you, rather than goof off, I was working to try to defend our climate. And you know what? I know you all here feel the same way, but to be able to say that is one of the greatest things I think I'll be able to say in life. So thank you all very much, and thank you for supporting our Children's Trust. And with that, I'll stop sharing and turn it over to questions.
Thank you, Phil. Thank you very much. We have a question from Alan asking if you can elaborate on the public trust premise that underlies the federal case.
Sure. So essentially what the public trust doctrine goes back to the Institutes of Justinian in Roman times, and essentially says that the state, the government, operates in a fiduciary capacity to current and future citizens, or current and future generations, who are, in essence, the beneficiaries of the trust, and that the job of the fiduciary or the government is to preserve essential natural resources, water, air, for not only this generation, but future generations. And so the public trust principle that underlies Juliana, it has also applies to our state cases and to cases internationally. Public trust doctrine in essence says that if the state has breached its fiduciary or trust responsibility, then the court can step in and, like it would in your own estate plan, for example, take over and apply remedies so that the trust race or the assets of the trust are restored to where they should be. And that those there's several United States Supreme Court cases on the public trust doctrine. In Illinois, they attempted to sell away Shoreline, and the Supreme Court said under the public trust doctrine, you can't do that. There's many cases, and I'm happy to send anyone briefs on the public trust doctrine if you're interested.
Thank you. A question from Flavia and Gary, Carrie, sorry. Even though the several dissenting opinions were well written in the cases that did not win, will those opinions have value at some point in the future?
So the short answer is yes. And the if you look in the history of Supreme Court scholarship, for example, you often find that the dissents of prior Supreme Court terms become the majority opinion later on. And that was the underlying principle of the NAACP when it started its legal efforts to get rid of separate but equal, particularly in the schools. It focused in on particular problems. It incited some dissents that then used the principles of those dissents to build on future cases. So now what we're trying to do is we're trying to learn from these dissents and build new cases that hopefully will result in majority opinions. Former Chief Justice Rehnquist of the United States Supreme Court wrote an interesting book. He called it The Supreme Court. And he talks about a very famous decision when President Truman took over the steel mills during the Korean War, and how the Supreme Court went from supporting President Truman to declaring that act unconstitutional. And they did that because not only public opinion, but legal scholarship, according to Rehnquist, had turned the court, had it caused the court to rethink the fundamental premise that it was supporting the president to do the act that was unconstitutional. And as a result, it turned the court around. And we believe that, fortunately or unfortunately, the current situations, wildfires, flooding, droughts, and are going to cause the courts and legal scholars to try to figure out a way that we need to stop the government from making the situation worse and having our government make the situation better. The theory that we work under a lot of the times is something called the state created danger doctrine. And I can spend more time talking about that at some point. But if you want a fascinating legal theory, one that we rely on a lot, it's the state created danger doctrine.
Thank you. Janet referred to the fact that you mentioned church groups making declarations of support. And she asks, are there guidelines for making such declarations?
Yeah, if you go to our Children's Trust website, the Action Toolkit, they will give you advice on how to do that. But we also have, and I'm going to bring this up now, it's often in litigation, you have support groups or what are called amicus briefs. And an amicus brief is submitted by an organization, an individual, or group of individuals or organizations on particular issues that are germane to the case before the Court of Appeals or the Supreme Court. And we've had a number of religious organizations that have supported us through submitting amicus briefs. And if you are involved in a church group, I'm happy to talk to you about how you can support us through what's called an amicus brief. And the final thing is, one area this Supreme Court, as we now know, based on the last term, is really focused in on is freedom of religion. Let's just call it that for a lay person's term. And so youth in church groups could be a future area of litigation. And it's something we're certainly very interested in. And because the Supreme Court attaches what I'm going to call an additional layer of protection when there's an infringement of rights and those rights are somehow grounded in freedom of religion or the First Amendment. And as a result, if you're in a church group that wants to get involved in the court system in litigation, which many church groups don't want to do, but if you are, please reach out to me or others at our Children's Trust, because we are always considering different approaches that will resonate with the Supreme Court of the various states or the United States Supreme Court.
Thank you. And if people are interested in not getting all those links, most of them are on the actions page, and I'll reference that again in a little bit when we go to the SOCAN part. So you mentioned that Kimberly, is she part of the team in some way?
She's a key part of the team.
Kimberly, do you want to unmute and make any comment at all?
Hi, everyone. I'm Kimberly. I'm a staff attorney at our Children's Trust that Phil mentioned. I'm co-counsel in the Virginia case and will be attending the hearing in September. I think Phil covered it really well, and I was just surprised dropping in on Phil because he is such an excellent speaker, and I thought I myself would try to learn from the best. So thank you, Phil, for that really great presentation.
Thank you. Thank you, Kimberly. Thanks for your work too. We have a few more minutes if anybody would rather ask a question rather than putting it in chat. If you want to raise your hand, we'll recognize you and you could ask a question.
I have a comment, and I'm gonna let Phil respond to this if he wishes. One of the reasons that we decided we wanted a program, a SOCAN program on our Children's Trust, is that several months ago, Kathy and I watched Youth v. Gov. We have watched a lot of movies, documentaries, videos that address the climate crisis. And I have to say that that was one of the most powerful videos that I have seen. And I strongly recommend anybody who hasn't seen it to try and watch it. I think it's about an hour and a quarter. It's not one of these 3-hour war and peace kinds of things. So if you get a chance, it's available on Netflix and it's really worth it. I think the elements, two elements in the video that really struck me were one that Phil talked about, and that was the the culpability of administrations other than the ones that we always blame for being anti-climate action. And that suggested to us that this problem is really much deeper than the government, because what's happening is institutions are really controlling to a large extent what governments are able to do. And what we learned from the video was how, and again, as Phil mentioned it, how even, if you want to say that, even the Obama administration, which I think many of us thought of as being pretty climate sensitive, even that administration was not beyond culpability in terms of promoting fossil fuel use. The other element of the movie that I found really interesting was watching how Our Children's Trust Executive Director Julia Olson was so sympathetic and effective in helping the plaintiffs stay with it and work on getting ready for the cases. And so I strongly recommend, it was one of the few movies I've ever actually written a review for.
Alan, I want to respond in two ways. First off, for those in a federal case or state case, you have what are called expert witnesses. And in Juliana, one of our expert witnesses is Gus Speth. And again, if you see the movie, you'll see Gus. Gus is one of the commentators. Gus, when you're an expert witness, you write a report. And I'm not sure you can see this all, but the MIT Press turned Gus's expert report into a book called They Knew. They Knew came out last year, and it's essentially what the federal government has known over time. And Gus has a particular perspective in that during the Carter administration, he was chair of the Council of Environmental Quality, CEQ. And so he writes from the perspective of, well, what did we know in the Carter administration? How did we get to know that in the Carter administration based on history? And what did our government do with that knowledge? So I would commend you to read They Knew. It's just about, just today, I think it came out in paperback, and you can order that. But the second thing, second comment I want to make is not only about how incredible Julia is, which is, if you get a chance to see Julia speak, she's just remarkable. But I want to talk about our 21 youth plaintiffs. I don't know what you were doing when you were 8 years old, 15 years old. I was out goofing off, riding my bike, watching dumb shows on TV. These 21 plaintiffs decided that what they wanted to do with their lives is sue the federal government. And we explained the implications to them of taking on the federal government. It doesn't get any more than David and Goliath and 21 kids taking on the largest government in the world. But these youth not only spent hours and hours with us working on the complaint, they've worked on declarations, they've testified under examination from Department of Justice attorneys, but they've attended every hearing, they have testified before Congress, they've done just everything you could possibly ask of an advocate to really represent the urgency of the problem to their generation and to be models of how the climate crisis can be solved if you just listen to these youth. I've been practicing law for over 40 years, and they are far and away the clients I am most proud of. And I really want to just mention that when you see them in the movie, I think you're going to be amazed and how they've grown over the years as a result of this case, how they've been through the traumas of being a plaintiff and major federal litigation. And I just can't say enough about them.
Thank you. We've got a couple more questions in just a few minutes. One from Flavia and Carrie. How did Children's Trust grow from a single case to so many related cases worldwide?
So when we started our Children's Trust, we had organizational meetings. We had the first one was in Eugene. The second was down by San Francisco Airport, and the third was in Denver. And we invited attorneys from all over the world. We invited climate scientists like Jim Hansen to speak to us. And the idea was to develop cases then, back in 2010 and early 2011, under the public trust doctrine. And over time, it's evolved to not just the public trust doctrine, but through to constitutional rights. So bringing a case, as Kimberly well knows, it involves not just understanding a particular state or country's legal system, but it's finding attorneys, local attorneys who are familiar with that legal system and willing to work for free, youth plaintiffs who are willing to take on the state or national government, and expert witnesses who can point to actions of the government that are causing or exacerbating the climate crisis. And so we've been building each of these cases over time, but as you can imagine, that is a very difficult thing to do, to bring a case in a new state or in a different country. And some of them have not gotten off the ground for various reasons, but we're continuing to move forward, and hopefully we'll be able to bring cases in more nations as we're really ramping up our global efforts.
I think we'll finish with Kayla's question. Kayla is focused on the children in the cases, the youth, and how emotionally difficult it must be. Does our Children's Trust happen to connect the youth with counseling to help them deal with climate grief? Or are there other resources for them that you're aware of?
Well, yes. The short answer is yes, we do. We have not only do we connect the youth with counseling, but we also do training for our staff and attorneys associated with our Children's Trust on trauma-informed care, so that we can see it in our plaintiffs and we can help our plaintiffs deal with the situations, because you find in these cases, particularly when you represent youth, that they are very affected by what's occurring. And it's tragic to see them. And that's why it's very important that we have experienced counselors who are, the youth know, have met the counselors. We give them contact information. And these counselors have been trained in addressing issues like the climate crisis. We also have expert witnesses like Dr. Lisa Van Susteren, who's a noted, world-renowned expert on the effects of the climate crisis on the mental health of youth. And she's spent time with many of our youth plaintiffs in formulating her expert reports.
Thank you.
One other thing I just want to add, Kathy, through our Children's Trust, you can reach me. I had my email in the last slide, but you can reach me through our Children's Trust or Kimberly or others. If you have other questions or you have thoughts or inspirations, please reach out to us, because I hope you don't view this as Phil's giving a talk and I hope to never see him again. I hope that what instead this inspires you to get involved with us and turn this into a significant part of your lives, or the lives of your friends and family, in addressing the climate crisis through helping our youth.
Thank you. And for the questions we didn't get to, Phil has agreed, after I do the last little bit here, to stay around for a few minutes. So if you want to stay and ask some final questions, he'll stay with us. So thank you very much, Phil. Alan has a comment while I get ready for the next part.
Okay, one quick comment. One of the things we don't often do at our SOCAN meetings is suggest to folks that they should make contributions to another organization. Of course, we're grateful to contributions that are made to SOCAN, but I would think that if there is any organization that's deserving of your financial support, it's our Children's Trust. So I would encourage you to think about that.
Thank you. So several times Phil has referenced information websites. And so what we've done is, if you go to socan.eco/action, and then you have a choice of individual or collective. If you go under the individual column, there's the heading environmental justice, and the information on the page should help you get to the links that you need to follow up on the things that Phil has talked about. I'd also like to invite you, if you are not on our email list, we send 2 to 3 emails per month. And if you want to sign up for that, go to socan.eco, and on the right side, you'll see this image where you can sign up by putting your email address, your name in that box. What I'm going to do next is go through some SOCAN activities and also activities of other groups. If you don't catch the details, because I might go a little quickly, if you go to socan.eco/events, you'll catch the information about each of these. SOCAN is having its 10th anniversary. If you haven't heard, we are very excited that we are 10 years old. This is going to be September 17th at 5 p.m. at the Hilton Garden Inn in Medford. And tickets are going, and we are limited. So if you're interested and don't have tickets yet, please go to socan.eco/anniversary, and you should find all the information you need there. SOCAN has 5 different programs, and under each of the programs are projects. I'm going to share with you different projects that are meeting in this next month. The federal state project will meet on Monday, September 12th. This is a Zoom meeting, and the information, the details for this are on the SOCAN calendar. This group is developing candidate forums, and these are going to happen at the Medford Public Library. They're going to be on October 4th and 18th. From 7 to 8:30, we invite you to mark your calendars and join us for those events. All people running for those races have been invited to attend. Also under the government program, the County City Project, this is the project meeting, is September 22nd from 1 to 2:30. It's when people that are leading the different action teams get together and share. And then the action teams that are meeting, the Medford group is going to meet on September 2nd. That's a Zoom meeting. And the Jacksonville action team will meet on September 12th. And that's at the Jacksonville Public Library. The Natural Resources Program, the Forest and Fire Project, will meet on Wednesday, September 21st. And that is a Zoom meeting. We are getting ready for the Master Climate Protector 2023. This is in the education program. If you don't know, this is a 10-week course is going to meet on Mondays. And we believe that we're going to be in person, possibly masks, but we'll be in person at the Higher Education Center in Medford. So Can at Mountain Meadows, this is part of our community engagement program, meets on Tuesday, September 6th at 2 p.m. This is in person at the Jefferson Room in the clubhouse in Ashland. Sustaining Climate Activists is a group that gets together monthly. The next meeting is September 24th. We meet at Blue Heron Park in Phoenix with a chance for people to socialize, but then also with a little organized checking in to see how climate activists are doing. Anybody is invited to come to this. If you haven't been before, you're welcome. You're invited to join us. The monthly meeting, September, we are not going to have a monthly meeting because we have the anniversary celebration. So our next monthly meeting will be in October. It'll be on October 25th. We have other programs that projects that are not meeting but still exist. If you're interested in Climate in the Classroom presentations or any of the others on this page, and if you don't catch the person to contact, you can always send an email to Kathy at socan.eco and I'll get you to the right person. Also, more programs under natural resources and community engagement if you see things that you're interested in. And again, if that's too fast, if you go to our webpage, socan.eco, those are all on that main page. SOCAN has a leadership circle that's made up of people leading the different projects. If you want to join us just to see what's happening, you're invited. Our next meeting is going to be Tuesday. Normally we meet on Wednesday, but this one will be Tuesday, September 13th, and this is a Zoom meeting. A few things from other groups, just quickly to go through. UNITE is having a Celebrate Our Community Strengths on Friday, September 9th, and SOCAN will have a table at that event. This is an excellent opportunity to engage with the ever-growing Latinx community. So if you're interested in joining us just for coming, just show up, or if you want to help us at our table, send me an email. We'd be glad to have your help. If you speak Spanish, that's great. If you don't, we still would really enjoy having you. Southern Oregon Citizens Climate Lobby will meet in September on the 10th, Saturday morning at 10 a.m. at Washington Federal Bank in Ashland. The OLLI class, Greenhouse Gas Emissions in Southern Oregon, will start on September 13th. You need to register with OLLI if you're interested in that, and Alan will be teaching that 10-week course. Southern Oregon Pachamama Alliance Community has their Rogue Valley Water Solutions Summit. The first conversation will be on Wednesday, September 14th, and the title is Honoring Water. And ROCPAC is Rural Oregon Climate Political Action Committee. They're our voice on climate action. Hogan Chereau is in charge of that if you're interested in checking that out. We have Rogue Valley Voice, which has on their calendar different climate action events. So if you're interested in those, it's roguevalleyvoice.com and then post upcoming climate action events online. And finally, I would like to offer a very big thank you to our speaker, Gregory, for sharing all the expertise of all that work. It was very special to be able to hear that from you to help us understand. And to Alan and Laura for making this possible, for doing the initial arrangements and setting things up. And Laura is with our Children's Trust. And thanks also to all of you for joining us. The value of these presentations is the action you take. So strongly encourage you to go to socan.eco/action and then find the page for our Children's Trust and check out some of those links. There's a petition there you can sign, as well as other actions. And finally, an email was sent to you about 15 minutes ago. It has in it a survey. If you would take the 2 or 3 minutes needed to complete that survey, we do appreciate the information. And if you have questions that weren't answered and you want us to get those to Phil, you can put that in the survey and we'll pass those on. SOCAN's website, questions, info@socan.eco, we'll get those to us. And please consider a donation if that's possible for you. And as Alan said, also strongly consider our Children's Trust as you look at donations you're able to make. So with that, I will stop the recording.